We'd like to welcome our visitors who are here with us this morning. It's an honor that you're worshiping with us, and I pray you would come and be with us again very soon. All right. Our worship service today is Divine Service Setting 3. You can find it beginning in the front of your hymnal today on page 184.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sins.
We pause for a moment of self-examination. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your blood, Son Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Lord, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in his stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the intro for the day, which is put before you on your bulletin insert.
Yeah.
is from Ezekiel chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. And he led me around among them, and behold, there were many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. And he said to me, Prophesy over these bones, and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a sound, and behold, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone, and I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and the flesh came upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut clean off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, Behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. I will bring you into the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land, then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans chapter 8. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Jesus Christ from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sin, sinful flesh, for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise and honor the hearing to us.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 11th chapter of St. John. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus in Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, The illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him." After saying these things, he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover." Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." When she had said this, she went to call her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said these things, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, our God, in His great mercy, does something throughout the Scriptures that we must always bear in mind. He consistently reminds us of who He is and what He alone does for you and for me. Those two questions, the who and the what, must always remain together if we are to take great comfort in the things that our Lord does. Two things in particular, when you read through the Old Testament, you encounter this over and over and over again, that the Lord our God has created the heavens and the earth. And not only, God alone creates. And the second thing, God alone redeems His people. The God who creates is the God who recreates. He alone has the power to make you new. And this is the very thing that He does. Have you ever wondered why John, at the beginning of his gospel, begins by reflecting upon creation? In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. All things were made by Him. Not one thing was made that He didn't make. Here John echoes the very beginning of Genesis, that in the beginning, God said, and as He spoke forth His Word, all things came into being. The God who creates is the God who governs His creation, is the God who recreates His creation for Himself. Now ask yourself, who is this God who creates according to the Scriptures? And we need to hear this answer very clearly. The God who creates is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is the Father who creates through the Son by the Spirit. It is the Word of the Lord that goes forth and creates the heavens. And it is the Spirit of His mouth that creates all their hosts. Psalm 33. Or once again, Psalm 104, as the Spirit goes forth, all things are made, all things are renewed. The God who creates, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is the God who recreates. Bear in mind what we've discussed so far in the Gospel of John. As we've traveled here throughout Lent, we've been spoiled, I would say, with all of these beautiful readings from the Gospel of John. Again, John begins with creation. Why? Because God alone creates. It is the Father who creates through the Son by the Spirit. It is the Son who takes upon flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we've seen His glory, the glory of the only Son of the Father. And we see that glory as He comes to you and to me to recreate us, to make us new. The Father, John tells us in chapter 5, the Father is life. That's who the Father is. And so too, John goes on to say, and the Son is life. And so too, we would quickly add, is the Spirit life. The life, the one who gives life to us, who sustains us in all of our ways. Now, do you remember as we began here at Lent, it was Jesus who went out into the wilderness. And there the devil sought to assault Him in various ways. And every time, Jesus returns for you and for me to the very Word of God. The very creative Word of God. It is the Word that gives life, eternal life, for you and for me. And then we came to Nicodemus. There at night, he comes to Jesus, and Jesus says what? You must be born again. You must be born again by water and the Spirit. The Spirit of regeneration and renewal will come upon you through the waters of holy baptism, waters joined to the Word, making you holy, making you new, making you a child of God. Not by the will of man, not by blood, not by birth, but by God, making you new and making his child. For Nicodemus protested, how could that be? And Jesus continues to instruct him, but then he says something interesting. He says, just as Moses raised the serpent in the wilderness, so too the Son of Man, who descended from heaven, will be raised up for you and for me. Our life is a gift from God. He created that life, and he comes seeking you, the sinner who has turned your back on him. He comes seeking you that by water and the word, through holy baptism, the Spirit would recreate you and make you a child of God. And then it's the woman at the well. The woman at the well, lost in her own sins, coming to Jesus who thirsts. Jesus who works at night and during the day, who thirsts and is tired, seeking out all. And he comes bearing the waters of eternal life. Rivers of living water. Again, the gift of the Holy Spirit. To remake you and make you new. To be a child of God is to know the God who created you, who recreated you, who sustains you in his ways, and who protects and guards you in all of your works and all of your doings. And then it was the man born blind at birth. You want to see, you want the scales to drop from your eyes, you want to see the world as it is, you want to rightly understand who you are and the world around you. Only Jesus can open your eyes. And when your eyes fall upon him, he is the one you see, and all life has meaning. You get it. You belong to him. And then we come to Lazarus. Chapter 11 of John's Gospel. Here too we have this wonderful lesson shown to us. Our life is in his hands. He who says, where is Lazarus, true man, is also true God, who says, Lazarus, come out. The one who seeks Lazarus seeks you. The one who said, Lazarus, come out, will say those very words to you someday. We'll say those very words to our loved ones who have gone before us. Perhaps a husband or a wife, a brother, sister, or a child. The one who seeks you out is the Word made flesh. The one who bears our iniquities. The one who suffers, the one who thirsts, the one who endures all for you has the power of life in his word. And he too can say, Lazarus, come out. And he comes out. Now, why is all of this happening? It was a long reading. Rest assured, we won't go verse by verse through this reading. But note at the very beginning what Jesus says to the disciples. Lazarus has fallen asleep. They're confused by that. They wait a little bit longer, but Jesus is going to go to Bethany. The disciples are confused. They seek your life. The Jews tried to stone you. Why would you go back there? Jesus is going to the cross. He knows what lies ahead. He's doing this for you and for me. And this is what he says to the disciples. This needs to be done. And it needs to be done that you would see. And what is it that we are going to see? We're going to see the glory of God. That the Son of God may be glorified in what he will do there in Bethany. And so they go to Bethany. And we come to Martha. Martha comes first. Martha, the diligent one. She comes out to Jesus. And she said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If only you had been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus says, but Martha, your brother will rise again. She says, I know. She says, I know. Jesus had said back in chapter 5 that indeed the Son of God would open the graves and all would come forth and come out. Here she gives her own confession to that, something throughout the scriptures that indeed God seeks his people and he will bring them forth. There will be that resurrection that we saw read about in Ezekiel. But look what Jesus goes on to say. He says, Martha, I am the resurrection, and the life. Once again, it's that divine name that he spoke to the woman in Samaria there at the well. I am. The Father has life in himself. It is who he is, and so too does the Son and the Holy Spirit. I am the creator of the heavens and the earth, Martha. It is through me that all things were made. It is in me that all things find their purpose and meaning. I am the resurrection and the life. When you, blind by your sins, are claimed by God and the scales fall and your eyes open, you see only one thing. You see Jesus. You see life. You see the resurrection. You see the one who has come for you and for me. Jesus says, whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. All of our family and friends who have fallen asleep in Christ, who have gone on before us, those who die in faith, they shall live again, for they belong to him. They have been claimed in holy baptism by the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They have the gift of life. But Jesus has more to say. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. My friends, you live this day as a redeemed child of God. You belong to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. You are his child forevermore. You shall never die. Jesus turns to Martha, and he turns to you, and he turns to me, and he says very plainly, do you believe this? Do you believe I am the resurrection and the life? Martha confesses, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. We've heard that confession before, haven't we? This is St. Peter's great confession, when Jesus says, who do people say that I am? People are confused about who Jesus is. They see the things he's doing, but they're really not sure who he is. He calms the sea, the waves, they listen to him. He walks upon water. Who is this man? Who do people say that I am? Peter confessed, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Martha confesses, you are the Christ, the Son of God. John tells us at the end of his gospel that this was the whole point of it all, that you would come to believe that he is the Christ, the Son of God, and believing in him, have eternal life. You are the Christ, the Son of God. We need to dwell here for just a moment. What is she saying? She's recognizing both what he does and who he is with this great confession. You are the Christ. You are the one promised from Genesis 3:15 beyond to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to David. You are that promised blessing to the nations. You are the one upon whom the Spirit falls. You will be high and lifted up. You will bear the iniquity of us all. You are the Christ, the Messiah, the one in whom alone we have salvation. It is your name, the name of the Lord, upon whom we shall call. Because there's no other name given under heaven by which we can be saved. You are the Christ. You have come, tabernacled among us. You will bear our sins. You will fulfill the law for us. You will conquer sin, death, and devil. And this is so because of whom you are. You are the Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father. You, born of the Virgin Mary, true man, true God. You who can say, where is Lazarus? You too can say, Lazarus, come out. This is our great confession, recognizing who Jesus is as the very Son of God, and there seeing the things that he does for you and for me. Well, Peter misunderstood. Martha doesn't quite get it, though she doesn't receive the rebuke that Peter received. Mary comes next. And Mary says the same thing to Jesus. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. He was deeply moved. Deeply moved. I said this a few Sundays ago, that when Jesus sat there at high noon in the heat of the day, talking to the woman of Samaria, he was thirsty. His humanity is true and it is genuine. He has endured the things that we endure. Or he doesn't give in to the trials and temptations in the way that we do. But he has endured, and he does all of these things for you and for me. He was deeply moved by Mary and the others. And so he then says, where have you put him? Where is Lazarus? And they take him, and he says, take away the stone. But Martha doesn't quite understand. No, don't do this. He will smell. And Jesus once again, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? Those who understand, according to the scriptures, what it means for Jesus to be the Christ, which is a stumbling block and a scandal for men, but those who understand that the very Lord of glory, the creator of the heavens and the earth, will go to the cross, and he will do so, shedding his blood for you and for me, because of our sin and our rejection of God, God himself will take our place. Those who understand what it means for him to be the Christ, they will see the glory of God. And so Jesus, he lifted up his eyes. He prays to the Father that others would see. And then he says, Lazarus, come out. I hope you noted carefully that in that Ezekiel reading, it is not the prophet who raises those dry bones. It is the Lord of heaven and earth, the creator of all, who speaks forth life into those dead bones. Not the prophet. Here it is Jesus, the very Son of God. Lazarus, come out. Put your own name there. This is the name by which he called you. You hear his voice and you are his. Good Shepherd Sunday is coming quickly. We belong to him. And he has called you to life that is abundant and filled with great joy. You belong to him, and you will this day and forevermore. He who has sought you out, he who has given you life without any merit on your part, has recreated you and redeemed you without any merit on your part. He is your merit. He is your righteousness. He is your holiness. He is your life itself. As your eyes fall upon Jesus. One last thing. It was a little bit beyond the reading, the long reading that we had. It comes right next here. The people see what Jesus has done, and they don't like it. They worry that too many people are going over to Jesus and that the Romans will come and take our place and our nation. They don't like that what Jesus is doing will threaten their hold on the things of this life. Do you see that? They want to value the things that are passing away. They want to cling to the things of this life. They don't want this Jesus who is the resurrection and the life. They don't want this Jesus who has just said, Lazarus, come out. They want the things of this world. Jesus tells us that where our heart is, that is our treasure. We must be like that blind man from birth who was given sight by Christ. We must see Jesus as we go forth every day of our lives. Why? Because it is only in seeing Jesus that we rightly understand the things that surround us in this world. We rightly understand all of the gifts and blessings that God has showered upon you and upon me. We repent when those blessings take too much of our attention, when they drive us from hearing the Word of God and receiving the sacrament, when they keep us to ourselves and not bringing us to Jesus. We repent. We do not value the things of this world over our Lord, but rather, when our eyes are open, we see these gifts as blessings, as opportunities. We have been called to be stewards of the wonderful gift that our Lord has given us, that we could love and serve those around us, always keeping those things in their proper perspective. We're not like those who fear Jesus because they may lose their place in their nation. Dear friends, the raising of Lazarus is pointing us to Holy Week, pointing us to Good Friday, pointing us to the celebration that we will have on that Easter morn. And as we gather then, we can say one thing: because He lives, we will live too. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We continue with the offertory. Receive our thanks for raising Lazarus from the dead, and direct our eyes to see in this miracle your own resurrection to everlasting life prefigured. Comfort us in our sorrows, and help us to grieve not as a people without hope, but as those who anticipate the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Gracious Lord, you honor the love and care within Lazarus' family, and you know the ties that bind his family, friends, and community. Fill the homes of your people with your spirit and with faith. Bless husbands and wives, and lead them to live in faithfulness to their marriage. Bless parents and the children you have placed in their care. Help us to live in love toward you, toward our family, and with our neighbor. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Mighty Lord, you hold all things in your hand, and you know the limitations of our power. Give us good and honest leaders in this and every land. Bless them with wisdom to heed your commands. Honor the path of virtue and punish the wrongdoer. Protect those who protect and defend us, especially the men and women in our armed forces. guide us, so that we may honor the sacred gift of life from conception until the end of this earthly pilgrimage. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Holy Lord, you have called and gathered to you a people by your Spirit through your word. Continue to provide faithful pastors and church workers to serve your people in your holy name. Bless the work of Pastors John Jenkins, Carl Beckwith, Fred Reinhardt, and the Federowitz family. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Gracious Lord, you know the suffering of your people, and you are present with us in our weakness. Give courage to the sick and those who suffer any need, that they may not waver from the truth. Give to our dry bones your healing grace and spirit, that we may be sustained in the day of trouble and delivered according to your merciful will. Hear us especially, we pray, for Anna, for the family of Joyce McNuff, and for the family of Henry Connell. We also pray for Pam, Kay, Willard, Linda, Cindy, Terry, Alan, and Dorothy, and all whom we now name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Living Lord, you have promised to open the graves and raise your people to everlasting life. As we recall those who have gone before us, we cling to your promise and await the great and blessed day when you shall come in your glory to reunite heaven and earth and to finish your new creation. Until that day, keep us in our baptismal grace and faith, so that we may become blameless and ready when you come in your glory. Lord, in your mercy. All these things, Lord, grant us according to your gracious will, keeping from us all things harmful, and giving to us only those things which are good and profitable to us and our salvation, until that day when we shall see you face to face, and rejoice with Lazarus, Mary, Martha, Ezekiel, and all the saints in your presence forevermore, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue now with the service of the sacrament on page 194. The Lord be with you. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.